Today is the first Sunday in Lent. Lent is a time for reflection, contemplation, and sacrifice as we journey with Jesus to the cross and to the empty tomb. It is a time to give up some things, and of course also a time to take on some things. To give up the things that have occupied our lives and that has had no bearing on God and even on others. And a time to take on things that reminds us about God and about what is precious and dear to God's holy name. It is a time for fasting and praying, a time for renewal of faith, affirmation of truth, and faithfulness to God. It is a time to follow Christ, and we do this best when we care for the forsaken, the neglected, the lost, and the poor. It is time to get back to God and to godly endeavors, godly living, and godly lifestyles. It is a time to proclaim Jesus Christ to ourselves and to the world. This indeed is the business and purpose of the church and of Christians, to proclaim Christ in word and in deed. This is our business. The question is, are we minding our business? Minding our business is defined as evangelism, a word that is often not appreciated in churches. And that's largely because of the way we choose to do evangelism. The way we choose to do evangelism is one thing, and what evangelism is all about is another thing. And as Christians, and as the church in particular, our task and our function is to proclaim the good news of Christ. The word evangelism comes from the Greek word evangelion. And that word simply means good news. And it means the task of the church to give, to spread good news to the world. We have been speaking about our church and where God wants to lead us into. And we've been speaking about the mission of the church. And last week we looked at the fact that we are called to worship and glorify God. And today we look at the fact that the task of the church is to proclaim Christ to the world. The loving presence and grace of Christ Jesus to a lost world. And so this is the business of the church. And this is indeed the business of all those who would proclaim to be Christian. It is absolutely the business of the church. We often do not want to embrace evangelism because we don't want to mind other people's business. But sharing your faith and testifying to the grace and love of Christ is indeed your business and my business. We are called into this particular task of proclaiming Jesus to the world. We have been saved to serve. We receive to give. We are blessed to be a blessing. And blessing others is indeed the business of the church and of all Christians. There are three great things that God calls us into. And if we had to summarize the business of the church into these three things, what are those three things? So as we talk about evangelism this morning, I want to put these three things to us, which defines and describes the purpose and the function of the church. The first purpose of the church is what we refer to as the Great Commandment. In Matthew chapter 22, verse 36, one of the Pharisees came to Jesus and asked him, "Which is the greatest commandment in the law?" And we are told in this passage that Jesus replied with two things. Firstly, he said to the Pharisee, Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This indeed is a great call. Note the fullness and the full effort that is actually implied in this particular verse. Love God with your whole heart, with your soul, and with all your mind. It's a sense of completeness. It is a sense of surrender. It is a sense of holding no part of your life back, but giving everything to God, lock, stock, and barrel. And so why should we love God in such a full measure, you may ask? Well, the answer is a simple biblical one. Because God gave us his all. Because God loved us in the measure in which he did not even spare his own son, but gave Jesus up unto death so that those who believe may have life. Lent is a time for us to ponder upon this fact. That as we start our journey now from Ash Wednesday, which we celebrated in the past week, right up until Easter Sunday, this journey with Jesus should be a special journey. It should not just be another Good Friday or another Easter celebration. And very often these moments and special celebrations have come to mean little for us. It's just that time of the year, so we say. But it is more than just that time of the year. And it will only be just that time of the year for you if that is the kind of attitude and approach we take concerning Easter. But if our attitude and approach says, I want to feel and experience the nearness of God. I want to taste something of his suffering and his death. I want to indeed replenish in his glory, then the experience of Easter is going to be something totally different from the usual. Certainly not just another Easter. So Lent is a time to stop, to reflect, but more importantly, Lent is a time to take up our crosses and to follow Christ. A time to deny ourselves and to devote ourselves to God and godly things. Why? It is all because of love. There's no pressure, there's no push. There is a sense of freedom and a call. A call that says, you are loved. God loves you so much that he came in his son to die for you. Karl Barth, one of the greatest theologians in the world from the Reformed faith, was once asked to summarize the gospel. And he said, this, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Simple as it is, yet powerful. For that is the message of the scriptures. This, I suppose, is a good enough reason to love God. There are many who love God, indeed they do. And that is wonderful. But how many love God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind? In that sense of total surrender, holding nothing back. You see, to love God is not to own God, but to be owned by God. To love him is not to keep him to ourselves, but to share him with others. The celebration of Holy Communion speaks about the broken body of Christ. And when we celebrate communion, we speak about the broken body of Christ given to us to share. To share. We share in his death and in his suffering. And equally, we share in his resurrection. But we also share in the responsibility of giving that good news to those around us. And so we do that until he comes in remembrance of him. Note what Jesus says to the Pharisee. He He said, the first and the greatest commandment is to love God. But he did not stop there. The second thing that Jesus said to the Pharisees is this: love your neighbor as yourself. Strong words there, love your neighbor, but it's qualified as yourself. Now, a lot of people love themselves, but also there's a lot of people who don't love themselves. So that's a little bit questionable in terms of how you view it as yourself. But let's assume that people love themselves and want the best for themselves and want to achieve the best for themselves and want to give of themselves. In that sense, love your neighbor as yourself. So if you love your neighbor, you share, you give, you communicate truth, love, and grace. You tell them about the love of Christ. Now that's not minding their business, but it is certainly minding yours. Doing what God is calling you to do. Taking on your responsibility to share the good news of Christ to the world. Of course, the way we share is absolutely important. Gone are those days when we should choose to be judgmental, condescending, or arrogant. And there's a lot of people who actually kind of share the gospel in that way. And we are not called as Christians to share the gospel in such a way. If we are to follow the example of Christ truly, then we realize that when we share the good news of the gospel of Christ, we ought to do it in love and humility. We do it out of care and concern. And this leads us into our activity of proclaiming God to the world. Billy Graham was once stopped from going to a particular place to preach because he was known to be a fiery preacher who preached the gospel without any compromise. And some of the pastors in that particular area said, well, we don't want Billy Graham to come here because he's going to set the church back at least 50 years. Because we have gone away and moved into a new dimension of proclaiming the gospel. And Billy Graham responded, actually, my task is not to set the church back 50 years. I want to take it back to 2,000 years. To when Christ came and Christ offered himself the good news for the world. So the way we do it is important, but do it we must. The second great thing and purpose of the church is found for us in the Great Commission. God always calls us into a task. It may be big or it may be small, but nothing, absolutely nothing, is insignificant. The Bible is full of stories of how God calls prophets and priests and kings and ordinary people into his holy task to reach out and save the world. God calls Abraham to leave his comfort zone and to go into the unknown. God calls Moses to go to Egypt and to say to Pharaoh, let my people go. God calls Noah to build an ark in the middle of a desert. God calls the disciples to leave their nets and their families and to follow him. God calls Paul to be his apostle to the Gentiles. God calls Zacchaeus to come down the tree and to serve him justly. God calls Mary to bear the Christ child. God calls Mary and Martha to open their home to strangers and give hospitality. God called a Samaritan woman at the well to worship the Messiah. Different people, different tasks, but God called them and commissioned them to his business. There is nothing better in this life than doing God's business. Amen? You don't really believe that. There is nothing better in this life than doing God's business. And so we are called to mind God's business. By minding God's business, we make God's business our business in this life. So what is God calling and commissioning you to do? If you say, I don't know, and if you say, I'm not sure, it means that you are not listening. It does not mean that God is not talking, because God is always talking. God is always saying something to us. God is always putting something on our mind and something in our hearts. God is always calling us to do a task, a purpose for Him in this world. Sometimes our lives are so crowded with other things that we cannot hear the voice of God. It gets lost or it gets faint in the many things that are part of our life's activities and mind's thoughts. That is why Lent is a good time to clear out the distractions and to listen for the voice of God. And that's what I want to encourage you to do as we proceed into Lent and as we come to celebrate the great Easter day. That we will take time to be still before God. That we will take time to ask God, what is it that you are saying to us or to me to do? We will take time to listen for the voice of God. In the midst of distractions, we will be still and know the presence of God. Sometimes we hear what God is calling us to say, but we don't like it. We don't like what God has to say. We don't like what God is calling us to do. And so for many people, we are looking out there today for a different voice. You remember the story of the guy who fell down the cliff? And as he got down the cliff, he managed to grab onto a branch, and he was holding onto this branch for his life. And so he asked and cried out to God, Lord, what must I do? Lord, what must I do? Please help me. And God said to him, let go. So he thought he was not hearing quite correctly. And so he looked up and he looked down and he said, no. God, what must I do? He cried out again. And the voice became stronger. Let go. He looked up and he looked down and he said, no, I don't think so. That's the right voice. So he pleaded again, Lord, what must I do? And this time it was thunderous. Let go. He looked up and he looked down and he looked up again and he said, is there any other voice out there? We don't like the voice of what has been told to us. We want to hear another voice, because it's easier to go with that voice that we are comfortable with than to go with a voice that comes from God that takes us out of our comfort zones. This was Jonah's problem. We read this beautiful story. But if you read chapters 1 and 2 firstly, you will get the full picture of what Jonah is about. God is calling him to go to Nineveh. And he doesn't want to listen to the voice of God. Instead, he wants to go to Tarsus because it's easier for him to be where he wants to be and not what God is calling him to do. And so he wanted a different voice. And he chose his own way. And we know the story. God had to struggle with Jonah. Jonah was swallowed by a fish. Prayed in the belly of the fish, and he was sent out again, and then he went to Nineveh. And now when we read the story in chapter 3 of Jonah, it is one of the most powerful stories of evangelism. Jonah goes there, and in spite of the fact that he doesn't want to be there, he still preaches the word of God to the people. And as he preaches the word of God, the king and all the citizens were reduced to repentance. With sackcloth and ashes, they repented. And the king declared Nineveh to be the city of God. What a powerful story. When we listen to God, God does wonderful things. When we listen to God, God does the impossible things. When we listen to God, God uses us beyond our imagination and our expectation. When we listen to God, God gets the glory. How prepared are we to listen to God? Many of us are like Jonah, always wrestling with God, always saying, do I do what he wants or do I do what I want? And we get stuck in this battle periodically in our lives. But it is only when we succumb to the will of God, it is only when we succumb to the purpose of God, do we suddenly realize how awesome God is. Some time ago, when I was still in the Cape and pastoring in the congregation, we had a chap who was actually, who had come from another community but had been with us in our congregation. And he was studying at the Cape Evangelical Bible Institute at that point in time. And he was very interested in becoming a missionary. And so he studied for 3 to 4 years with the intention of becoming a missionary and going to a particular place. And he wanted to really go. I can't quite remember now which place it was. Let's say China. He wanted to go to China. And really was waiting for it. And when he finished his studies, he couldn't wait to go. But it just never happened. He linked up with a missionary organization called OMF, Overseas Missionary Fellowship. And then they started to delay the process. And it took a year and it took a second year and nothing was happening. But in his spirit, he wanted to go to China because he believed this is what God was saying to him. But it didn't happen that way. At the end of 2 years, he came, and through the time I was counseling with him, because he was really getting frustrated. Here I am, I'm ready to go, and God wants me to go, and I'm responding to his call upon my life. And what is happening? Why is nothing happening? And I had to say to him, Charles, all of this is part and parcel to the preparation that God is putting you through. It's within God's plan that you be thoroughly prepared for what you are called into. But 2 years later, he was called to go not to China, but to the Philippines. And he said, I don't want to go there. Don't want to go there. And I said to him, Charles, your task is to say, Lord, send me. And where it is that God is calling you, then you need to go. Now, Charles was a single guy. He was probably about 35 years old by then. And so we were talking a bit, talking about the fact that, you know, maybe he may not meet somebody and get married someday. And he said to me, you know what? I've actually come to peace in my life to realize that that's not God's plan for me. And so I've accepted that. So I'm prepared now to go to the Philippines. And so off he was preparing, and he went to the Philippines. He goes into the Philippines, and guess what? God has another missionary from England waiting for him in Philippines. He goes and he meets this lovely young missionary lady by the name of Liz. And a few months or a year later, they got married. God gave him everything, even that which he was not expecting. What is the point I'm making here? Obedience and faithfulness brings blessings. Obedience and faithfulness brings blessings. And that's what God is calling us into. So Jesus clearly stipulates for us the purpose of the church in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28, verses 16 to 20. And this is called the Great Commission. Jesus said to his disciples before he left the earth, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. This Great Commission is given to the church. In fact, this Great Commission is given to you and given to me because we are the church. God is calling the church to preach, to teach, to baptize, to make disciples. Yes, not all of us are called to be prophets and pastors and priests and preachers, apostles and teachers, for we are differently gifted. But all of us are called to be witnesses. Witnesses to the glory of God. A witness is one who testifies to what they have seen. That is what evangelism is all about. To share the amazing grace that you have encountered in your life about a faithful God. Testifying to the goodness of God in your personal life. It does not require education or knowledge. Just your experience and your relationship with God is enough to share the good news with somebody else. Nobody can challenge your testimony. We don't need degrees and eloquence. We just need faithfulness and willingness to open our mouths and willingness so by word and by deed we can communicate who Christ is. A congregation grows by word of mouth, by you taking the initiative to speak to someone else about Christ, by you taking the initiative to invite someone else to church, by you taking the initiative to tell somebody else about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Imagine if 10 of you went and told 10 more people and brought 10 more people to church. You got 20. Imagine if 20 of you then went and told 20 more people and brought 20 more people to church. You got 40. And so the number goes. By word of mouth, it is you and I who have to get up from our comfortable seats and go out and speak the goodness of Christ to the world. Today we tend to be more private about our faith. In some countries you are not allowed to share your faith. But sharing your faith without putting down other religions or judging others can lead someone to the greatest gift in life, salvation and eternal life in Jesus Christ. This is what we are called to proclaim to the world. And this leads us into the next point, the great consummation. The Bible teaches us that there is a day of judgment and that there is a day of consummation. Matthew chapter 24, Matthew chapter 25 gives us beautiful stories about judgment. Matthew 25 speaks about the 10 virgins, 5 of them ready and 5 not ready. And when the time comes, when the bridegroom comes, those who are ready enter and those who are not are lost. As difficult as sometimes we do not like this message, but that is the reality of the word. That is what the scripture teaches us, that we have to be in readiness to receive the Lord. There will be a time, a day of the Lord's return, when some will be taken and others left behind. There will be a day also when everyone will say, Jesus is Lord. When every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord indeed. The question is, do we believe this? Do we believe it enough to tell somebody else that Jesus will come back again? Do we believe it enough to proclaim this as good news to the world? This is our message. But God does not condemn the world. Jesus, in fact, said in John's Gospel, chapter 3, I have come not to condemn the world, but to save it. It is God's desire that none gets lost, the scripture tells us. The question is this our desire too? Some of our very own loved ones, our parents, our children, our siblings, our best friends and neighbors, would be lost to eternity. Why? All because we did not take the time to tell them about the love of Jesus Christ. You see, it is our business. Difficult as it may be to speak of Christ to our loved ones, we should seize the opportunity. Difficult as it may be to speak the name of Christ to people at our workplaces and our friends, it is our business to speak about Christ. It is our business to care for others. And that is what evangelism is all about. Caring for others. Caring enough for them and loving them so much that you will share the good news in Christ with them. Sharing the good news should be both our duty and our joy. I wonder whether this is yours. But let's put this all together. The great commandment is to love God and to love your neighbor. The Great Commission is to go out and to make disciples of all the earth. And the Great Consummation reminds us that there will be a time when God will return in Christ Jesus. There is the Lord's Day. And we need to be focusing on the future in as much as we live in the present. Because the day will come when the Lord will return. All of these things require one thing. It requires a great commitment from you and from me to share the good news. We don't have to be evangelists. God is not calling us to be that. May not be calling us to do that. But God is calling us to be witnesses. Lent is a time for great commitment. Are you prepared to commit to the things of God? Are you willing to commit to tell others about the love of Christ? Let's start at home with our loved ones and reach out to the world. We should not be embarrassed or ashamed of the gospel, because, as Paul tells us, it is the power of God unto salvation. We should not be settled with fear or lack of knowledge or indifference or leave it to somebody else attitude. Instead, we should take it upon ourselves to say, Lord, I am committed to tell someone else about Jesus. You have opportunities virtually every day to talk about God. People often may speak to you about their own struggles, their own disappointments, and their own pain and challenges in life. And this may be in your places of work, it may be in your places of study, it may be in the community where you are found. All of these are opportunities to tell somebody about Jesus. The problem today is that we often do not like God talk, and we do not like church talk. But it is our business to lead others to Christ. Is it your business? Are you prepared to mind your business? Minding your business is what evangelism is all about. It is about sharing the good news of Christ to those around us. I wonder whether we are prepared to rise to the challenge and to say in this time of Lent, I want to be the bearer of good news. I want to share Christ with those around me and beyond. May that be our joy. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have called us for a purpose. We may have different gifts, but we all are called to be witnesses. Witnesses as we testify to your grace and love for us in our own lives. Help us to go out into the world and in simple ways to share our faith simply. Not with judgment, not condescendingly, not with arrogance, but with love and humility, and with the joy to know that we have something to share that others need. Help us, Lord, to take the task of the church seriously, and help us to mind our business as we mind the business of God. So give us that joy and that ability to want the things of God, especially during this time of Lent, as we prepare our lives, as we take up our crosses, and as we follow you. We pray this in Jesus' name.